Section 9. Wow, that's so much faster. And we started on this. And we started, so I'll just review from the beginning of 9. And we talked first about these mothers that fought off polar bears and cougars and just all these heroic things. When their children were in danger, those moms just went crazy to protect their children and to get them out of danger. I know Josh is thinking about his mom would do the same thing. She would fight off a polar bear for you. I know she would. And not only moms, dads, but we have this in us from God, and God is the same way in that he wants to protect the people he loves. He wants to seriously protect them. He wants to jump in and do everything he can so that we will do the right thing, so that we will go to heaven. He wants to protect us from missing it. We visited a zoo in Thailand, I think I told you last week, where the missionary told us he walked by the cage when he was holding his son, and the jaguar reached both claws out and put him right into his arm and started to pull the boy into the cage with him. And the missionary unhooked the claws, and that's just a great example of the devil, of the world. That we're walking, if we get a little too close to that cage, they're just waiting to grab a hold of you and pull you away from the Lord into worshiping something else. We can't let them do that. And God doesn't want the enemy to prevail, to win in a sense. So we talked about the deep magic of the world, and I'm using that in quotes from Narnia, that God set up this world with certain rules, that as he works in this creation, he will not violate those rules. And one of those rules is, if we're not a worshiper of God, we will not go to heaven. No matter what a great person you are, no matter how anything, if you won't worship God, the rule is, and God won't change his mind on this, you won't go to heaven. And there's certain rules that are not bigger than God, but they're made by God in the creation, that when he is in this creation, he abides by those rules. Scripture, for God has not destined us for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's purpose for you has never been and never will be that you're going to be under God's wrath, but he wants you to be saved and he wants you to go to heaven. But the deep magic hold, the rules of this creation hold. And if we don't respond to God, if we don't worship God, he won't do anything about it. That's the way it is. So he, like a good parent, tries to rescue us, tries to warn us, don't go next to that cage. Moses, he had his problems with the people, right? He knew from an experience right after they left Egypt from the golden calf how quickly we could turn from worshiping God to, there we are, worshiping an idol. And that's what I want to talk about here tonight. I think, let me see, we started that last time, the golden calf, how quickly everybody turned aside. And did anybody ever see the movie Master and Commander? It's a great movie. It's about naval warfare. And one of the guys was walking along, and an officer was walking along. Well, he didn't like the officer, so he didn't yield, and he bumped shoulder to shoulder, and he kind of hit him, the officer. And the officer just went like this and kept walking. And the captain of the ship pointed to that guy, "Clap that man in irons!" Why was he so harsh? Because he couldn't tolerate rebellion against the officers on that little ship in the middle of the ocean, or it would be a real disaster. He had to keep things in order because rebellion is contagious. I don't know if you've ever been caught up in a rebellion against, I don't know. But as a result of the golden calf and the worshiping, 3,000 were killed. God said to Moses, go, and those that won't repent, those that stood there and said, no, I'm going to worship the golden calf. I don't care what you say. I'm not repenting. I'm going to worship the golden calf. That's our God. They were killed, 3,000 of them that day. And we talked about that last time. Moses had a mutiny on his ship. The whole purpose of the nation was to worship God. And so the high crime was worshiping a golden calf and refusing to worship God. That was a capital crime, worthy of capital punishment. So they were killed. Remember, we talked about it was a government and a church in one, the nation of Israel. Now, since Jesus, it's separate. The church doesn't kill people anymore, right? We'd like to something. No, not really. Not really. The government does. So we closed by talking about this beautiful 11-year-old girl that was taken from a bus and brutally misused. They found her body. She was alive. They brought her to the hospital. She's going to live. I found out now that they found the man. He's going to prison for quite a while. But we don't realize that the golden calf, and when they worshiped the Baal of Peor, that there was open sexuality and religious prostitution going on. And how that worked, who knows, but that they would go and say, hey, you, young lady, you're in. It's your turn. And we think, oh, they're just, why was God so harsh? Well, I'll tell you what I feel like doing to that guy who did this to this 11-year-old beautiful little girl. I don't feel too nice toward him right now. And so we can't judge God for this. But Moses came down. He saw all this going on, had the 3,000 killed under the Lord's instructions. Now he goes back up with two more tablets. So we can see how gracious God is in that he now gave them a second chance. So you have I don't have that up there. Okay, so there you are. So he went back on the mountain, and here's what happened. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood there with him as he called upon the name of the Lord. Then the Lord passed by in front of him and proclaimed, the Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin, yet he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished. It's a rule. That's in this creation. That's the deep magic. That's a rule. Visiting the iniquity of fathers on the children and on the grandchildren to the third and fourth generation. And that doesn't mean the sin of the fathers the children have to account for, because obviously the people in the wilderness sinned, but their children went into the promised land. You know, he didn't hold that account. And Moses made haste to bow low toward the earth and worship. What was Moses doing here? Draw the picture. What was he doing? Bowing low. That's what worship means, to bow. So it said Moses made haste. It's like, okay, God. He bowed low toward the Lord, toward the earth to worship. Why was he doing that? Why was he bowing low and worshiping the Lord? What's that? Showing reverence, yes. Somebody else? Yes. Here's a kind of a fantastic part. Worship is saying yes to God when he initiates telling us kind of go to India or go to or love your husband or whatever. It's like, okay, I'll worship you. Yes, God. You know, we may not sing, we may not do anything, but just yes, God. That's worship. Here, what has God just told Moses? How does he describe himself? In the beginning of this passage, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, abounding in loving kindness and truth, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin. So Moses is here, and God is basically saying, look, I'm going to punish the guilty, and they're already punished. But I want you to understand this, Moses. I am going to forgive all iniquities. I'm going to forgive all wrongdoings. And so how is Moses responding to God saying, I'm going to forgive you? What's he doing? That's right. He's bowing low and worshiping. We don't only say yes to God when he says, I want you to be an usher. We say yes to God when he says, you're forgiven. You're forgiven. That's worship. And oftentimes, you know, we come in feeling crummy on Sunday morning, maybe even tonight. And as we're there, we're not just singing. If we're worshiping and God is saying, look, you had a bad week. I understand. And I see your heart. And you're sorry for it. And it's been a rough week. And you're repentant. I forgive you. And are we supposed to say, oh, no, I'm not accepting that. I'm going to stay ashamed of myself. I'm going to stay feeling guilty and bad about myself. That's not worship. We're not worshiping God if we say no. God doesn't only initiate direction to us and kind of guides us in the way to go, things to do, not to do. He forgives us. And when he is forgiving us, our worship response is to bow low and say, yes, Lord, I receive your forgiveness. It's your will for me. I accept it. You with me on that? Anybody have a rough week this week? Anybody step over the line a little into something that just needs forgiving? I'm closing my eyes because I don't want a response. But, you know, typically our hand could go up because we don't have perfect weeks every week, right? And God may tonight be telling you, even as I'm speaking, you're like, wow. Okay, I'll worship him. I need that forgiveness. And that's what he wants. When he comes to you and says, I'm forgiving you, he doesn't want you to say, oh, no, I don't want that. He doesn't want, that's not worship. That's not what he wants. He wants you to say, thank you, Lord. You're awesome, God. He wants you to worship him and accept what he has. So that's what Moses is doing here. Listen, no other God can forgive you. The devil cannot forgive you. He can only make a mess. He does not have the authority to forgive you. So when we worship the devil in various ways or other gods, can those gods say, well, I forgive you, and we say, oh, thank you, I'll receive that. Can we say, no, they don't have the authority. They may pretend like they do or everything else, but that's why we don't worship the devil. We don't worship other gods. We go to the God who can forgive us and wash us clean, our sins white as snow. We worship him. We accept what he has for us because he loves us like a parent and he wants to give us good things. Amen? All worship of everything else is just in vain because they can't do anything. The golden calf, none of those. They can't do anything. So the people had messed up. Many died. Moses called on the Lord. He's now face down. And God tells Moses again. Just finish that. Now he goes on. But rather, you are to tear down their altars and smash their sacred pillars and cut down the Asherim, for you shall not worship any other god. For the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Now, God didn't go to him and say, Moses, 3,000 people killed today. You did a good job. Just take it easy now. Just lay back. You're fine. Did he say that? He gets right on it again. He doesn't let up for 1 second. He wants every iota out of any worship that doesn't go to God. He wants it out of our lives. And he's going to keep on it. He does not let up. He's a jealous God, it says. He didn't say, just rest, Moses. You had a rough day. It's okay if you... It's okay. You don't have to worry about this for a few days. He sends him right back into it. Why does God get right back on this topic again? Why doesn't God let up? Why doesn't God just give him a break from idol worship? I mean, just take it easy. Just take it. Don't worry about it for a few days here. Yeah. Our life depends on it. It's important. Why is God... Or what does it mean that God's jealous? It says that For the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. What does it mean he's jealous? He wants all of us. He doesn't want to share. And we talked about the exclusive marriage relationship. And there's a good side of jealous. We're not supposed to, oh, yeah, go ahead, sweetheart. I don't really care. That's not the way it should be. There should be that jealousy, that protection, that guarding, that I want you all for myself. I love you. You're mine. So he's jealous of what? He's a jealous God. Of what? He loves us, yes. What? Yes. Totally devoted, that's right. He's jealous for us, that's right. And it's a good thing. It's not a negative attribute. So he says his very name is jealous. Do you think parents are jealous of their kids? Jealous for their kids? Yeah. And so if the kid is going to go play in the middle of a street, and the parent goes crazy and says, you can't, what do you think you're doing, little Johnny? Get over here, get in. You know what I mean? The parent is jealous for what? Their life, that they're going to do good, that they're going to live, they're going to survive. And that's what God sees. If we worship other gods, we die. Because of the deep magic, because that's the way this creation is created. So God is after it. He's on it. He's jealous for us. He knows how dangerous it could be. And he sees it with his people. Go ahead, George. He protects us like a parent. So jealous in this Hebrew word, gana, means demanding exclusive service. Exclusive. You exclusively belong to the Lord. Everything else, get your hands off. Get your hands off this person. She's a child of God. Other gods, devils, this wouldn't belong. Didn't there used to be a t-shirt or something, property of Jesus or something, or I don't know, whatever. But loyalty to Yahweh must be absolutely undiluted. Undiluted. Don't put too much water in the punch. It's got to be solid. We cannot have undiluted worship. What does that mean? What's undiluted worship? I mean, what's diluted worship? Okay? Compromise? What's when you dilute your worship, what does that mean? Yeah. It's kind of weak. Watered down. Nobody likes a watered-down can of soda. Here, pour the soda in and pour half water and half soda. Yeah. Right? It's diluted. And God, go ahead. It's not really soda. That's right. And that's exactly right. It wouldn't pass the Coca-Cola company test. It would be throw that away. That doesn't pass our quality control. And God wants all of us. He doesn't want us shared. He wants us exclusively. He doesn't, when we worship him, he doesn't want us thinking, well, I'm going to do this for you, God, but I have this other thing over here going too, so I'll give you 50%, and I got 50% over here. He doesn't want that. Now, we talked about the golden calf in the incident at Sinai hundreds of years later. God still remembers the golden calf. David writes this psalm. Hundreds of years later, God hasn't forgotten this golden calf. And he doesn't want the people to forget it. They made a calf in Horeb and worshiped the molten image. Thus they exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt. So that's hundreds of years later. At the same time, hundreds of years later from that incident, the people still worship the golden calf. when the nation of Israel split into Israel and Judah, Jeroboam took the north. He was the first king of the north. And he set up two worship places, one in the north and one in the south. And he put a golden calf in each. Isn't that amazing? It's like, what are you thinking? The prophets prophesied against it. They knew it was wrong. Within two centuries of Jeroboam, people were starting to kiss the calves on top of worship. And now, and I'm reading out of Hosea 13:2, and now they sin more and more and make for themselves molten images, idols skillfully made from their silver, all of them the work of craftsmen. They say of them, let the men who sacrifice kiss the calves. So now they're not just worshiping, they're kissing them. And that Jeroboam's sin is what was one of the major reasons they were dragged off into exile. God just said, okay, you want the golden calf? That calf's going to save you? See if the calf will save you. The problem is that people displace God with an idol and call the idol their God. They diluted it, but then they really got rid of God altogether for the most part. When Moses went up on the mountain the first time, the people says, well, we do not know what's become of him. Like, he's been there for a month. And they gathered all the jewelry. Hey, let me have your earrings. Let me have your nice necklace. Let me have your bracelet. And they gave it to Aaron. Imagine, they brought it to Aaron, and Aaron's like, okay, I'll just build a golden calf here. The whole thing seems bizarre, but let me read. And they said, this is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt. We read that last time. Now, when Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. So he had the calf. Now he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow shall be a feast to the Lord, the calf. So the next day they rose early and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. And it says, they have made for themselves a molten calf and have worshipped it and have sacrificed to it. So the problem here is not Aaron's artistic ability. He was a great artist. To be able to take and make a golden calf like that, that gift was given by God. That's not the problem, is it? The problem's not the altar. Altars are okay. Feasting is okay. Playing is okay. Singing is okay. Dancing's okay in the right settings. God enjoys all of that. God gave us that capability. What's the problem? What's the problem with all the feasting and the dancing and that beautiful artwork? What's the problem? Worshiping the wrong God. God gave them all those skills and gifts in art and gold and everything, and they go off from God and say, forget you, God. We're going to do this. They worship the work of their hands. That's what the commentaries say about these people. They wanted to see something going ahead of them. Yeah, that's right. But we know in the commandments, that is not what God wants. Yes. Yes. Right. They're very influenced by the surrounding cultures and the surrounding gods. That's right. And no image can represent God. That's why he does not want any image made of him. It just demeans God. And it actually pulls people away from God. And I don't know if I'm going to include it in here. It's a little side note, but I'm reading Calvin's works, and he's, of course, in the middle of the Catholic Church, and he's discussing right now in a section I'm reading about the statues and the everything in the Catholic Church, and he's making the argument about how it basically dilutes our worship of God. It takes something from it, because they could never, any worship of anything else dilutes our worship of God. And so, anyway, I'm not bringing that now. I'm just saying I'm in the middle of that. So this was the Egyptian bull god, probably, Apis. In Egypt, they worshipped certain magnificent bulls, alive, living bulls. They thought they were a god, and when they died, they would bury them as a god and all this kind of stuff. They exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that eats grass. It makes sense, doesn't it? So, golden calf, hundreds of years later, David writes about it. They're still worshiping the golden calf. 1,000 years later, just before Stephen is martyred, remember, this is after Christ, he's raised, now Stephen goes out preaching. Stephen reminds the Jewish people of their stiff necks, just like their forefathers, right? So let me read. He preached just before he was martyred, just before his death. And at that time, he's preaching to the Jewish people. And at that time, they made a calf and brought a sacrifice to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their hands. But God turned away and delivered them up to serve the host of heaven. That's one God, the host of heaven, just different bodies in heaven. As it is written in the book of the prophets, it was not to me that you offered victims and sacrifices 40 years in the wilderness, was it, O house of Israel? God saying, hey, I was there. You weren't offering sacrifices to me, were you, Israel? You also took along the tabernacle of Moloch, another god, and the star of the god Rampha, another god, the images which you made to worship them. I also will remove you beyond the Babylon, beyond Babylon. And then it continues. And Stephen says to the Jewish people there, you men who are stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears are always resisting the Holy Spirit. You are doing just as your fathers did. You're always resisting the Holy Spirit. You are doing just as your fathers did. Just for a little background, in the wilderness they worship the host of heaven. Now there's a nice little passage in Job that helps us understand what that looked like. Let me read it to you. Host of heaven might be the moon, the sun, the stars. Job 31 says, if I have looked at the sun when it shone, or the moon going in splendor, and my heart became secretly enticed, and my hand threw a kiss from my mouth. So he's talking about throwing a kiss to the sun or the moon from his mouth. That too would have been iniquity, and iniquity calling for judgment, for I would have denied God above. So in that little passage, we get this little view of worshiping the host of heaven. It's kind of like throwing kisses. Interesting, isn't it? Worshiping the stars and so forth. And people were influenced by all kinds of gods. They were a monotheistic people, one god living in the middle of a polytheistic world where they worshiped many gods. So the tabernacle of Moloch, they also worshiped. And we think, what's this? That's okay. Just a little god. Let me read out of Leviticus 20 what God says about this. You shall also say to the sons of Israel, any man from the sons of Israel or from the aliens sojourning in Israel who gives any of his offspring to Moloch shall surely be put to death. It was children's sacrifice. They would give their children and they would kill them to Moloch. The people of the land shall stone him with stones. Capital crime, right? I will also set my face against that man and will cut him off from among his people because he has given some of his offspring to Moloch. Just terrible. We can't even think of that. So as to defile my sanctuary and to profane my holy name. This was worshiping who they thought God was. Giving their children to kill their children toward this. If the people of the land, however, should ever disregard that man when he gives any of his offspring to Moloch so as not to put him to death, then I myself will set my face against that man and against his family, and I will cut off from among their people both him and all those who play the harlot after him by playing the harlot after Moloch. As for the person who turns to mediums and to spiritists to play the harlot after them, I will also set my face to get that person and will cut him off from among his people. You shall consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, for I am the Lord your God. So this was serious stuff that was going on. As they wandered in the wilderness, they should have been offering to God, but instead they were ignoring God and doing this crazy stuff, blowing kisses to the stars, giving their children to be killed toward the god Moloch. And one more I'll just mention, Star of Rampha, an image of a star. They don't know much about this. They think it might be Saturn, Egyptian origin. So there are these gods going on. So Stephen lists these. I just read for you several idols, false gods, including the golden calf. What is Stephen preaching here? He's saying they were in the wilderness offering to these different gods. And then he says, you men who are stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears are always resisting the Holy Spirit. You are doing just as your fathers did. What is he saying? What's that? Yes? Yes. Yeah, we sometimes think the Old Testament people who worshiped to idols and gods, they gave to Moloch, they blew kisses to the sun, whatever the idols were and the crazy stuff they did, we think, well, we don't do that. But Stephen is saying what? If you resist the Holy Spirit, you are doing exactly what they did. That's pretty strong. Stiff-necked means resistance against changing one's behavior. You got something going on wrong, and the Holy Spirit is saying, change it. That offends God. You're worshiping. That's not God. You're giving your time and your love to something else. Change that behavior. And stiff-necked is resistance against changing one's behavior. So, no. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to worship my golden calf. Leave me alone, God. Stiff-necked. Resisting means fall against, literally. Strive against, resist. It's like just pushing against it, like keeping the door closed. No, I'm not letting you in, Holy Spirit. I'm just going to, you're telling me this, but you want to come? No, I'm not letting you. I think it's kind of interesting that the Father in the wilderness was telling him this. That when Jesus came in the flesh, he was saying the same thing. And now the Holy Spirit is speaking to people, to us, all saying the same thing. You're going to die if you don't worship the Lord. Very consistent. Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Yes. Yeah, I mean, we could take that to where we live in a culture just like they did, and our culture has idols. It has gods. And they're not maybe obvious to us like Moloch, but they cause you to stray from. They cause you to resist the Holy Spirit because this Holy Spirit says, I want you to go this way. And you're like, ah, I want to do this right now. And so that's the same thing. It's resisting the Holy Spirit from what I'm seeing here. So there's something really important. It's not apparent here, but the Jewish people got so angry at Stephen that they stoned him to death after he said this. You're stiff-necked. You're always resisting the Holy Spirit. Just as your fathers did. Why would they stone him to death? Why would they be so angry? He exposed them. True. So, go ahead. What's that? Yes, he confronted them with their sin. And I think, you see, when the Israelites were worshiping idols and all this crazy stuff. God said, listen, I'm going to take you out. I'm going to take you out. I'm going to take you out. They kept doing it. I'm going to take you out. He gave them hundreds of years, warnings through the prophets. Finally, he took them to Babylon and exiled them for 70 years. When they come back from the 70-year exile, they never worshiped idols again. They were spanked, and it worked. They never worshiped those physical idols again. So, the 400-year intertestamental period came, and here they were. Jesus came. Now Jesus is gone. Now those religious leaders and the Jewish people are standing there, and Stephen is preaching to them, and he's saying to them, you're just like your fathers who worship Moloch. And what they're thinking is, you're crazy. We don't worship Moloch. Don't you dare tell me I worship Moloch. I don't give my kids to Moloch to be killed. I don't do that. And they stoned him. But they missed it. The problem is not Moloch. The problem is how we respond to the Holy Spirit. Not back just in the Old Testament wandering in the wilderness, but today, right now, how are we responding to the Holy Spirit? So, what does resisting the Holy Spirit mean? Yeah. That's right. This whole... George? Not listening. Not listening. So, God comes, and now he comes with the voice of the Holy Spirit and says, I want you to dot, dot, dot. Worship says yes. When we resist the Holy Spirit, we are not worshiping God. We're not his worshipers when we don't worship God. It's all about that, from the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, all the way to now. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Yes. That's right. So he loves us as a parent. He knows the deep magic is set. The rules are set. We're going to lose. So he's pursuing us. He's after us. Why is Stephen qualified to make this statement? What qualifies Stephen to preach to this group to say, you're stiff-necked, always resisting the Holy Spirit? What qualifies him to say that? And this isn't in this passage, but if you know the life of Stephen before, remember who Stephen was? He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He was full of the Holy Spirit. He was led by the Holy Spirit. He's preaching in obedience to God, even though it's gonna mean his death. He knows what this Holy Spirit obedience is, and he could see it in somebody else and say, listen, I could see it in you. You're just like your fathers. You're stiff-necked. You're resisting the Holy Spirit. You're not following the Holy Spirit. And he's not bragging. He's not saying, but I'm following the Holy Spirit. But he is. He understands what following the Holy Spirit is. I wonder if sometimes we really get a grasp of following the Holy Spirit, like unashamed, unreserved, reckless abandonment for our own lives, and just really following the Holy Spirit. And I don't mean just speaking in tongues once in a while. I mean our lot. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Holy Spirit. See, the false substitutes, golden calf, Moloch, kept people away from God's plan, from God's protection, from growing in God, from having the life that we wanted to have. So, You probably heard me and remember that I used to work for the Dow Chemical Company who made Methocel, a chemical that we sold to McDonald's. Methocel is a plastic. And when you put it in water, it swells. It's water-soluble plastic. And if you cool it, it looks like it's thick, like a milkshake. It's plastic. And we loved them. I don't know if they're still using it. But we used to love McDonald's milkshakes, right? Tastes great. It's plastic. It's plastic. Now, I'm not saying now. I don't know what they're making it out of. It's been a long time. This has been 30 years. But that's what they used to do. Plastic. It just had the right consistency to mimic, to be a substitute for ice cream. It was plastic. It didn't hurt you. It was cheap. So they made a lot of money. Well, you went there and ate your plastic. I used to go to schools to speak about career days, you know, when I was back as an engineer. And one time I went with a guy from McDonald's. And he's talking about a career at McDonald's and how Dow, McDonald's, you know. And it was so interesting because he had a chart, and he's basically saying, you cannot eat McDonald's too much. You have to eat good food. He had a whole chart of how much you could eat McDonald's, what else you had to eat. I thought it was hilarious. They're in the restaurant business. They're serving food, and he's saying, you just eat a little of our food. You can't eat too much of it. Oh, where's that? Okay, so there's a story of a man who was resisting buying oats. It cost too much, and so he fed his mule less and less oats and more sawdust. He would mix it up, and the mule would eat it, and it would be less, because he got cheaper and cheaper. He was saving money. Everything went fine for a while, but by the time the mule was satisfied with sawdust, he died. That's what the devil wants to do, is feed you sawdust. He wants to feed you Methocel. Oh, tastes good. This is great. I'm doing good. Leave me alone. I don't need the church. I don't need Jesus. I don't need the Holy Spirit. I'm doing fine. You ever see the movie Supersized? Anybody see that? It's about McDonald's and about the guy who, what is it, like 30 days. And they diagnosed. He went to a doctor and said, what's wrong with me? They said, are you drinking heavily? You're like an alcoholic. Your liver is failing you. He didn't drink anything. He just ate McDonald's. It was hilarious. I'm not on McDonald's. Well, maybe I am. So compare for me eating at McDonald's and worshiping idols. What am I saying? Neither one of them is good for you. That's right. They're fake. They're not real. The devil can't do anything for you. The devil can't give you life. The devil can't give you forgiveness. The devil can't bless you. God can. But if it tastes good enough... Remember when Jesus was confronted by the devil in the wilderness? And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. And he answered and said to him, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Jesus was quoting Moses when they were wandering in the wilderness, when Moses was speaking to the people. And this is, Moses is talking to people about manna. And Moses says this, and he, God, humbled you and let you be hungry and fed you with manna that he might make you understand that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Therefore, you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God to walk in his ways and to fear him. So all those 40 years, every day when they went out and got manna, God was trying to say to them, you've got to listen to the command of God. Forget that golden calf. Stop worshiping Moloch. There is a bread of life. It comes down from heaven, and it's God. He's given this to you, and he's feeding you, and he wants you to, when you pick up that manna, he wants you to remember, no golden calf. It's every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God that is life to you. You see what he's saying? This is what Jesus is repeating. So after Jesus fed the 5,000, remember that story? A few loaves, multiplied it. In Jesus, there's plenty. Fed everybody, 12 baskets left. There's plenty for everybody in Jesus. And it's the bread. After he fed them, the next day the people came back to find more bread. And Jesus answered them and said, truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes, the Methocel, but for the food which endures to eternal life, the word of God, which the Son of Man shall give to you. One is, it doesn't have value. The other has value. And then he says, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which comes down out of heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. Does anybody remember that song, All of God's Children Love? What's that? What's the words? All of God's children eat living, living. All of God's children love, eat living bread. Anybody? I was trying to think of that song, but I can't remember it. George? No? All right. Something like that. We got to eat the living bread. Not the dead bread or the stuffed Methocel bread. Meth bread. No, that has a different connotation. manna started right after that golden calf when they started out. God wanted to teach them a lesson for 40 years every day. It's every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. In other words, when God's word comes to us, we have to worship and say yes to that word and nothing else. So maybe they no longer went after those particular golden calves, but they were still resisting the Holy Spirit. Do you see? It's the very same thing. Resisting the Holy Spirit is saying no to the word of God, no to the life, to the bread of life, the words, the commands of God. After eating McDonald's, you feel full. Now, there's nutrients in the food, don't get me wrong, but... So Stephen connects idolatry to resisting the Holy Spirit. So now that comes right into the New Testament times and into our lives today. Anybody mad at me for getting on McDonald's? You probably love McDonald's and you're all mad at me, but I just got to speak the truth in love here. Anytime we're consumed with something which brings us to resist the Holy Spirit, we're in trouble. We're doing the same thing. The inward expression is the same, even though the outward expression is different. We're not on our knees before a golden calf or blowing kisses to the stars, but that all is outside expression. We're going to talk about that in the next whole section. But the inward expression is exactly the same. We're resisting the Holy Spirit, and that's what counts. The people who stoned Stephen in the New Testament were exactly like their fathers in the desert in the Old Testament. Different outward expression, same inward expression. So I was in an airport once with my son Luke. He's sitting right over there. And we had a really awesome conversation. It was about video games. You remember? You don't maybe remember. But we talked about what happens when you start to play video games a lot and the possibility you can become addicted to video games. You don't remember that, yet? And I was explaining to him that God's will, God has a will for us, a desire, if it's a straight path like this, anytime we get addicted, the addiction starts to pull us from the will of God. And so we're going along and we might be playing video games and nothing affects us and it's okay, or anything. And it's okay, but then there comes a point when God says something to do this way, and that addiction, that pull, pulls us away from, and our path starts to separate from the perfect will of God and the plan God has for us. Not that he was addicted, but it was a teaching moment while we're sitting there waiting for the plane. Whatever pulls us from the path God has, I mean, it could be an addiction. It could be an obsession. Why do you think one of the qualifications in this church is that we can't be addicted? In order to be a member of this church, one of the qualifications, you can't be addicted. Why do you think that is? Why do you think we put that in place? Yeah, Ted. Yeah, so we won't be off the path. So we will follow God. When we're addicted, we follow the addiction. Did you ever try to talk to someone about their addiction? Dangerous. It's like touching a raw nerve, like the tooth has been pulled and you just put your finger on that nerve. Nobody, don't you talk about my addiction. What? And it'll come right back at you. Fangs and claws out. And that's what happens with God, too. They're not free to follow the Holy Spirit. They have put an idol. They have put something else in place of the Holy Spirit that has a stronger pull, at least at times. So, let's see here. Oh, yeah, this is good. I'm going to save this section for the next time, I think. But, We're talking about this section is worship is saying yes to the one true God only, exclusively, undiluted. That's what we're working on in this section. So if we could have some, get ready for the worship, I will pray. Lord, show us if there's anything pulling us off course from your will.